Actually, it is youthfulness that is honoured, not age. And if you doubt that, let's go back to the comment we had earlier on about people worshipping their bodies. Put your hand up if you know somebody who consciously does stuff to their body to make themselves look older. Why is that? The reason is because our society is youth-focused. We might say a lot of negative things about young people and youth and this they do and that they do, but most people have got so caught up with this lie of eternal youthfulness that people spend a fortune. I mean, don't take this personally, but people spend a fortune on treatments and lotions and potions and tablets and surgery and this, that and the other to make themselves look younger, don't they? Why is that? It's because our society values youth and no longer values age.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called The 10 Words, Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 to 12, by Pastor David Wise.
If you turn with me, please, to Exodus chapter 20, you'll see it on the screen. Exodus chapter 20. If you've got one of our church Bibles, you'll find it on page 77. Exodus chapter 20, page 77. Exodus is probably the most important book, most significant book in the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and in many ways, it's the Old Testament equivalent of the Gospels. Some parts of the story are very, very well known. There are other parts that are not so. But we've already looked at the plagues. We've looked at the Passover. We've looked at the crossing of the Red Sea. And today we come to look at the first part of what many people call the Ten Commandments. I've called the Ten Words this morning. Familiar passages, but as we've seen as we've gone through, so often we don't understand the significance of those events for ourselves today. And so we've been a lot of work on that as we've gone through, trying to make sure we understand that. We're going to do the same thing today. And if you've missed any part of the series, I think this is part 14 or 15 today. If you've missed any part of the series, you can find them on our website, gbc.org.uk. And they're all recorded there in glorious Technicolor and good sound quality and all the rest of it. So you can look at those there for a recap as you want to go back over the series. So who was here last time, 2 weeks ago? Last time we looked at the Israelite nation arriving at Mount Sinai. Do you remember that? Who was here for that last time, 2 weeks ago? Six people. From what I remember, the church building was fairly full on that occasion. So what were the main lessons, you six honest people and others hiding in the congregation? What were the main things that we took away from that last time that we felt God speaking to us? Yes. We mustn't be casual with God. Very good. I do apologise for the sound. We've got a difficulty at the moment. I'm not quite sure what it is, but we'll sort it out as we go through. What else?
It's not because you've been long in the house of the Lord you hear from God. A new person can bring in fresh light.
New person bringing fresh light. That wasn't last time. That was the time before last. But you're absolutely right. People who, you know, are newly in faith, God can speak through them just as well. That was Jethro you were talking about. Very good. Something else that we saw last time. Well, two other things we saw last time that are quite important. Most important points Christine has got, but there were two other points as well. Carol.
God sets the terms of our relationship.
Yeah, God sets the terms of our relationship. We can't be casual with him. That's the other part of that. Yep, Mary.
It was a nice bit. You were talking about the eagle's wings. And God, you know, how the eagle saves her baby.
Yeah, we looked at how this whole image of the eagle pushing the babies out of the nest and how the eagle flies underneath and actually catches and carries us. We have that phrase. I think we had it earlier on this morning about being carried on eagle's wings, and it comes from there. What else?
Holiness,
yeah, not being casual with God. That whole thing of holiness. There were two other things as well. We talked about wilderness last time. Do you remember that? That actually sometimes we find ourselves as Christians in a wilderness, and it's not because we're being disobedient to God. It's not because we're in the wrong place. It's because that's where God's taken us. And that's okay, because it's in the wilderness sometimes God speaks to us. And one of the other things that we saw last time, an important point, but I made it in passing, was we jumped forward to the New Testament and we looked at the fact that Christians today are the inheritors of the promises to the people of Israel. We're the inheritors of their privileges, we're the inheritors of their promises. Now today, as I've already said, we come to this passage that's the first part we're going to look at today of what is known as the Ten Commandments or the Ten Words. And it sits at the very heart of God's revelation through Moses to his people. Now most of these ten are negative statements, and people sometimes think that negative statements are actually limiting. But actually, negative statements give you most freedom. Let me explain what I mean. If you've got a son or daughter, you say to your son or daughter, you must only go into this little park here. That's a positive statement. You must only go into this little park here. And it cuts off all the rest of the world. Yeah? But if you make the negative statement, the only place where you can't go is in this little park here, you've got the whole of the world. Remember in the story of the Garden of Eden? There was only one thing, one command. It was a negative statement. You don't eat the fruit of this tree. And negative statements are actually permissive statements. It sets the boundaries for life. Everything else is permitted, but this is the boundary. Anything else in the garden, but don't eat from this tree. So whilst it might feel a hard thing, negative statements, in fact, negative statements are permissive statements. They're giving boundaries and giving us actually a huge amount of freedom. The second thing I want to say about these statements is that they still apply today. There are some bits of the law in the Old Testament that were fulfilled when Jesus died on the cross. And so we don't need to kill animals anymore and spread their blood about and a lot of the other ceremonial laws. But these moral laws still apply. And in fact, Jesus made it very clear that these don't just apply to us today. He took it to a much deeper level. We're not going to explore that as we go through these. But he took them to a much deeper level. You've heard that it was said, do not murder, said Jesus. But I say to you, do you remember those?
Yeah.
So they still apply today. One quote, a guy called Alec Motyer, he wrote this. I read him this week. The Ten Commandments show what a rounded, perfectly balanced life should look like. The Ten Commandments show what a rounded, perfectly balanced life should look like. So let's begin to look at these. We're not going, as you can see, all the way through today. We're going down to verse 12. We're going to do the rest next week. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. And God spoke all these words. This is a rare event. There are very, very few places in the Old Testament where we find God speaking and his words being heard. God sometimes spoke to prophets for them to speak to the people, but here is God speaking directly. This is very important. It's very important also because it emphasizes the source of these words was God himself. God himself is behind these 10 words, these 10 commandments. And it wasn't just God himself, it was the God who'd set his people free. You see, sometimes people have such a negative view of Christians that we're spoil sports. We don't want to do, we mustn't do this, you mustn't do that, you mustn't do the other. That God brings these rules and regulations to stop us enjoying ourselves. In fact, it is absolutely the reverse. Because God wants us to have life and enjoy life and not to get damaged in the process. And it was God who'd set his people free. Remember, we'd seen the story of him coming to Egypt, of setting his people free from bondage, where they were the victims of a program of genocide in Egypt and forced labor. And God set his people free. Amen? And God set us free also as we jump forward right to now, hasn't he? God set us free. You heard Asher's testimony earlier on. Life was in a mess. She didn't go into the details. I'm not going to unpack it. But life was in a mess. Life was really difficult. God broke into her life. She met some Christians. Found God in her life. Set her free to be all that God has made her to be. Now it is that she's having all these different breakthroughs in life because now she's able to be the person that God created her to be. Amen. And it was that God who set his people free, brought you out of Egypt, brought you out of the land of slavery, who then brings these rules, these commands here. Because he wants the people to reflect his values, to reflect his nature in the way that they live their lives. So they are to be total in their commitment to him. You are to have no other gods before me. The people of Israel are in a number of respects like us. They were surrounded by people that worshipped other gods. They had animists, polytheists, all sorts of different religions around them. Everywhere they were surrounded by people who worshipped other gods. Same for us here, isn't it? In London, or wherever it is that you come from, we're surrounded by people that worship other gods. Nothing unusual about that. Nothing exceptional about that. But God is very clear. I have brought you out of slavery. I have set you free. You are to have no other God before me. These other gods are not to be allowed any space in our lives, in their lives. The commitment to him must be absolutely total. And it's that statement that heads up this list. These other things are going to unpack that a little bit as we go through. But the commitment to him is to be absolutely total. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. No idols, no images of the Lord, of God, Yahweh. No images of him or anything else for worship. No representations, pictures, models, anything to represent God whatsoever. Why? Because anything that anybody makes to represent God misrepresents him. Anything you can think of Any picture, any image, anything that you can make to represent God is going to actually misrepresent him. I mean, for example, anything you make, it's going to be in one location, isn't it? God is everywhere. It's going to have certain features on it. God is spirit. And we need to understand that this isn't just, you know, something that's, well, take it or leave it. We need to understand how offensive to God idols are. They're offensive to God. Idols of any sort, of any description, are offensive to him. He says, I am a jealous God. Now, before you think badly of God, we need to understand that word jealous, not purely in human terms. You know, sometimes you might feel jealous as a human being because somebody's got something that you haven't got. Yeah? This isn't that sort of jealousy. This here, perhaps zealous is a better word to explain it in English terminology. You see, God sees his people as his bride. Old Testament, New Testament, images in both places. The church is the bride of Christ. The nation of Israel is the bride of Christ. And we are a part of that. Now, let's move it into the human realm for a moment. If you are a husband or a wife, and your other part, husband or wife, actually begins to have an affair with somebody else, you're going to be upset about that. It's offensive to you. And yes, you're going to be really emotional about it, and yes, all those other things are going to be there, but there's something about rejecting you in that process. And it's that same thing here. God has this exclusive relationship with us. And we start playing around with something or somebody else, we need to understand that that's a very serious thing. And God takes offense at that. And it's not jealous, you know, he's got out of bed the wrong side. It's because we are creating offense to him, because we are rejecting him. We need to understand how serious that is with God. And there is this phrase that God uses here about this punishing the children for the sins of the fathers. Now, in our very individualistic Western culture, we think, well, that's grossly unfair. Honestly, you know. If Wasim, I'm just going to pick on him because he's in the front row and he hasn't got any children, so he's not going to take it personally. You know, Wasim does something wrong, why should his children suffer? Well, God should just punish Wasima. Let me tell you, if you think that, you don't really understand life. Now, just imagine Wasima. You're right with this, aren't you? Because I used you in a really positive image last time I used you, so this time it's a negative one, okay? Now, just imagine Wasima is married and he's got children. And Wasima gets into all sorts of bad things. Now, you can fill in whatever you want to fill in that expression, bad things. Are his children going to be affected by that? You bet they are. And in fact, I know from pastoral work that I do that you get something that actually Wasima might do. That why don't you just affect his children? His children's children will be affected by that as well. That's how life is. And we had this fantasy, this Western European fantasy that somehow what we do, as long as it's in, I've heard this so many times, what I do in private, it doesn't affect anybody else. What an idiot would say something like that. Some arrogant, self-centered idiot says something like that. Of course it affects other people, because we are interconnected people. We have relationships, we have people around us, we have family, we have friends. What we do affects other people. And if Wasima, I'm sorry to keep picking on you, but I mean, I know you're up for that. But you know, if Wasima in his relationship, he decides, I'm going to reject God and I'm now going to worship, fill in whatever you want. Of course that's going to affect his kids and his kids' kids. That's what God is saying here. You choose to go in some other way, and it has implications. It's not that God is thinking, oh, Wasim has done that, I'm going to give his kids a nasty time. It's just how life is. It is how the world is made. Things that we do have consequences for other people, including the next generation. So, if you're a visitor here, let me explain that at various points when I'm teaching, several points today, I stop and I ask a question, not a preacher's question, but a question for some conversation and dialogue together. These first six verses that we've talked about, let's make it specific for our cultures today, our culture that we are in here in West London, or our culture that we normally live in if we're visiting somewhere else. How do these verses, how do they apply specifically into our culture, our situation today in 2008? What do you think? Because it's not enough just to think about, oh, that's very interesting. All those Israelites out there in the past, well, that's fascinating. So what about us today, Mary?
This is not meant to be a red herring, but what about pictures of Jesus and representations of Jesus in churches? Is that all right? Because
The difference there is that in Jesus, God came as a human being. Okay, I mean, it is a reflection of God as a human being. And so pictures of Jesus as a human being are a reflection of something that God has done and a way that God revealed himself through us. So that isn't the same as... But it does become an idol. It can become an idol. In itself, you have to look at why is this picture there? If this picture is used as an object of worship or a way of directing worship to God, then it has become an idol. You see that in the Old Testament. There are a number of occasions where there were things. A bit later on in the story, there is a bronze serpent that was made. And it was made at God's instruction. But later on, it became a snare to the people because they began to worship it. So we need to be very, very careful. We have on the wall here an artist's impression of Jesus on the cross. It's a helpful image. But if that becomes something that we are praying towards, or we are directing worship towards that, it then becomes an idol. And that then is a problem. So, yeah. So how do these things, a very good question, Mary, how do these things apply into our culture? Carol.
Gods can be, not other religions, but anything that we put before the living God.
Okay.
Like, wealth and success and...
So these can become idols for us then. So money, success. How do they become... Excuse me, point picking on you, but how do they become an idol? What I mean, we've all here got money. I mean, some have got more than others. Some haven't got very much. Some haven't got enough. But we've all got some money. And having money is not wrong.
No.
So what is the difference between having money and money becoming an idol?
Well, that is just your focus of just getting money. I mean, God wants us all to, excel in whatever we do and do our best in everything. And that's our reason for, working hard and trying hard at school or at work or whatever. But we're doing that to please God.
So it becomes an idol if it becomes our goal, that we're actually doing this to get money. So money becomes something that our life revolves around, then it becomes an idol.
And you wouldn't entertain anything that was going to distract you from that. So.
Yeah. Interesting. We'll come back to that in a few minutes' time, actually, because that crops up again later on. Thank you. What else? It's a very good observation. It's not just about other religions, but it could be about other things. Any others? Joan?
Ambition can be an idol. It can be the focus of your life. It can be what you're striving for. And it might be a totally different direction from what God wants you to
do. Okay, so ambition in terms of achieving something for ourselves rather than actually God's path for our lives. So that our life can again revolve around that, and that could become an idol. Yeah, very good. I don't mean very good if people does that, but it's a very good illustration.
I've realised that.
I just thought I'd make that very clear. Anything else? Yeah. Say again. Worship of the body. Yeah. Yes. We're going to pick that up a little bit later on as well, but that's a very good, you know, the way that people, it's not wrong to look after our body in the same way it's not wrong to have money, but it can become something that becomes an object of worship. Yeah. Mary?
Things like addictions to perhaps television or computer games, or where people take their standards from what they're looking at all the time.
The internet, Second Life, all of that sort of stuff that is there on the internet. Some of the things with television, computer games, these things can become a centre of life, and they can become an idol in themselves. Okay, very good. Let's move on to verse 7. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. So this is about bringing God's name into disrepute. How do people do that today? What things does this cover today?
Swearing.
Okay. Yeah. What else?
Well, with a broader view, really, we all do it when we sin.
Okay. Yeah. Sinning is something that's bringing disrepute to God's name. Yeah. We do anything wrong. Yeah. Saying again?
Making oaths.
Making oaths, yes. Using God's name to swear. Something which I think this applies to that. When I go to court, usually giving evidence on someone else's behalf, I have just to make that clear. But when I was in court a couple of weeks ago, I made it clear I won't swear on the Bible, because I think that goes against this. I will choose to affirm. And so that's just the line that I take with that. But yeah, thank you. There's something else really big that we've not picked up here. Yeah.
This might not be your son.
No, it might not be, but give it a go.
People just saying, oh God, oh God knows, and just throwing God's name around in a casual way.
Okay.
That has no meaning.
Yeah, so people throwing God's name around in a casual way, God knows this, God knows that. Yeah, okay. Now there's another really big thing that I think brings God's name in, I think probably globally, brings God's name into disrepute more than, in some cultures, more than anything else. It's the use of God's name for our cause. When we start using God's name for our cause, we've got some particular political line or some particular policy, human policy, and we claim to be doing it in God's name. And we see politicians doing that on a number of occasions in the last few years. And that, in my opinion, whatever their policy is bringing God's name into disrepute. Because we are claiming that God is on our side. And God's always bigger than that. God is always bigger than that. Do you understand? And so I think that brings God's name into disrepute. And there have been some spectacular things in history where people, I mean, the biggest and most obvious one, which there have been echoes of in recent years, is the whole thing of the Crusades. You know, in God's name, going and conquering these people, leaving aside everything else about it that was wrong, it was misusing God's name. It was misusing God's name.
David, would you say that it's inappropriate to sort of have, say, whatever, I don't know, the Christian Democratic Party, would you say that's inappropriate?
What, calling ourselves the Christian Democratic Party or whatever, is that inappropriate? I think we need to be very, I don't mind that name, but if a politician stood up and said, you know, of that party or some other party, and claimed that they were on, you know, God was on their side, this was God's cause, God has called me to this policy, I'd begin to think that's not right, that's moving outside. I mean, you question when somebody starts adding the name Christian to their party, political party, because politics is something, I believe Christians should be involved in politics. This is just down the side here. I believe Christians should be involved in politics. Most of you will know that I am involved in politics. I'm an active member of a political party, and I think we should be involved in that. It's important to be involved in that, but we must recognise that actually as a part of politics, it is a broad grouping, and there are things in any party that the party I belong to, there are things I agree with passionately about, there are things that I don't agree with. There are things that actually I would say, well, these reflect God's standards. There are things I say, these certainly do not reflect God's standards. And as part of what I do in the party, try and see campaign to see those things changed. And recognise that there are Christians involved in all the major political parties in this country. So when we start trying to claim that our particular space here is Christian, I think we're on dodgy ground. So I wouldn't, if I had a party, I wouldn't want to add the word Christian to it, because I think that's claiming more than is there. So, okay, let's look at this next one. Verse 8 to 11. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labour and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall do no work, neither you nor your son or daughter, your manservant, your maidservant, your animals, nor the aliens. The alien, by the way, is not the Martian living within your gates. It means the people of other nations within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. We need to understand a very important creation principle here. This is not something that's about doing this because we are Christians. And it wasn't something about the Hebrew nation doing it because they were Jews. But actually, one day of rest in seven is a part of how God has made us as human beings. It's what one man I read this week, Dunham, calls, I like this phrase, a Sabbath rhythm in our lives. A rhythm that includes relaxation and reflection in order that our souls and bodies may be renewed. I like that. A rhythm that includes relaxation and reflection in order that our bodies and souls may be renewed. Someone else that I read this week, a guy called Freedom, he came across this phrase I like. A weekly oasis to rest back in the arms of this reality. Talking about God. A weekly oasis to rest back in the arms of this reality. We're going to talk in a moment about how this applies for us here. Because we live in West London, it's a 24/7 world, isn't it? Shops, businesses, work. We've already had people who are here in part of our worship meeting this morning who've left now because they are working later today, working shift work. Have gone. One man has left, he's a baker, so he's gone off to work today, so people have got bread to eat tomorrow. So it isn't simply about the fact that everything should stop on one particular day. Life's more complicated than that. So we're going to ask in a moment, what does it mean? But I need to say something. Something I hear people say often, I hear businesses arguing it, and I hear all sorts of people arguing it. They talk about the fact, well, if we didn't do it for 7 days, it would cost us money. As though that's something that is new. I mean, in those days, the people of Israel, you know, if you're a farmer, or whatever it is that you were, these were largely farmers, whatever it was, and others later on were doing other trades, the fact that they didn't do their trade for a day meant there was some loss involved, financial loss involved, material loss involved. A huge gain involved in terms of rest and relaxation and rhythm of life, but also some financial loss. So let's think together about our world today, our complex world, our 24/7 world that we live in. How does this principle apply for us in our world? Thinking about issues like hospitals. Some of you here are nurses and doctors. What does it mean in the context of a nurse and doctor? What does it mean in the context of, say, that man that's left who's a baker? What does it mean in that context? What does it mean in the context of a church pastor? Should he not come to church on Sundays? I just throw it in as a random thought. So what does it mean? What does it mean in our contexts, in our situations? How does this principle, which is a creation principle, one day of rest in seven, how does this apply for us in our society today? I mean, while you're thinking about that, some of you will remember, when you were younger, that on a Sunday nothing happened. I mean, I don't know if they used to do it here, but certainly where my mum grew up, they used to chain the swings on Sundays. The council went round on Saturdays and they chained all the swings on Sundays in the local park so the kids couldn't play on them on a Sunday. I mean, everything shut on the Sunday. I think apart from the pub. I think the pub was open at lunchtime. But everything else was shut. And some of you remember, you've been around a bit longer than some of us, you remember those days. How does it work today? What does this principle mean for us today? Yeah.
Is a Sabbath day, is it, it's a specific day?
One in seven.
Yes, it's just any day of the week that you could. So if you're a hospital worker, could it be your Sabbath day Wednesday, if it's your rest day?
Okay, so you're saying that it's not day specific, it actually is person specific. Okay, if that is the case, and that may well be, how does that apply in the rest of society? Does society need a day that is different? Or should all 7 days just be the same? And we all have a different day off, and it doesn't matter as long as we all have a day off on a different day, but the rest of society just goes on. Is that what it means? Remember we had that campaign years ago, the Keep Sunday Special campaign? And, shops are limited. Our local big superstores, they can open 24 hours a day all week apart from Sundays when they're only allowed to open for, is it 6 hours? Is it 6 hours on a Sunday? It's the only time that, the shop's not open 24 hours. And it's because of the Sunday trading laws, which go back to this whole issue of keeping Sunday special. Yeah. I saw a hand here somewhere.
Yeah, they promised when they started this that Christians or anyone else who objected wouldn't suffer from this. They wouldn't have to work Sundays. They wouldn't miss out on promotion or whatever. But it hasn't happened.
No. The promise, for those of you at the back didn't hear that, the promise when they introduced this Sunday trading was that Christians would be protected from having to work on a Sunday and they wouldn't, lose promotion and all that sort of stuff in the future. And that just hasn't happened. Hasn't happened at all. So what does this mean for us? Trevor?
Breakdown in society, breakdown in respect, breakdown in honour.
Okay, so where this isn't honoured in society, there is a breakdown of society. Breakdown of relationships, breakdown of respect, yeah? But how do we live in this? What do we do? Mary?
Thinking that when the manna came down, they didn't have to gather it on a Sunday, was it, or Saturday?
Saturday, it was the Sabbath for them, which was Saturday.
God made it last and he provided. And I think people that do honour God, like students particularly, might say, well, I can't come to church, I've got to stay home and study. But if they study as hard as they can and honour God on the Lord's Day, then I think God will provide, like he provided with the manna, if we put him first. But it's individual, isn't it?
Yes. So, we went back to the manna story, that their double, in fact, was delivered in our calendar on the Friday, so that on the Saturday, at the Sabbath for them, they didn't need to go out and collect anything. Yeah. And that God does provide for us. Yeah.
Does it not have something to do with greed? because people who took more manna than they needed, didn't it?
Yeah. So there is something about greed here and preventing greed, yeah? Hi, yeah.
Could it be also saying that there's a breakdown in family, Christian family? I mean, looking at that verse, basically, I think it was made to bring all Christians, together as a family. So, I mean, in most families, normally you have days where you expect everybody to come home and, do certain things. So I think as Christians, it's also, in a way, not for us to give up and keep trying to give, bring everybody back together, in the Christian family on that specific day that's possibly meant to bring everybody in fellowship and worship, worship God.
Thank you. That's a really important point. One of the big arguments for keeping Sunday special was the fact that it provided a day when families could actually be together and could spend time together. And that if different people in the family were having different days off, there never was going to be a day when the family could actually be together. And so that would have a consequence in breaking families and breaking relationships. And we're seeing some of the consequences of that in our society today. Trevor.
I'm not sure where it is, but somewhere in the scriptures, this particular day of rest must hold importance to God because he even asked for the land in the seventh year to be left fallow.
Yes. It's a similar principle in Deuteronomy that the land actually had a year off. One year in seven, the land was left fallow. And God provided bumper harvest for the year before. So what else with this? How do you apply it in your own lives? Come on, I mean, you all live... most of you are here, are Christians, you're seeking to serve God, but you're also living, the fact that you're here in West London means that you are living in this 24/7 world. So how does this work for you? How do you apply this? This is a creation principle. How do you do it in life? I'll come to you in a moment, Susan. Eunice.
I think what God is trying to tell us about the Sabbath day is just because he loves us so much. He doesn't want us to overwork ourselves. Like, as everybody is saying, he wants us to have a time of rest so that we can get refreshed and, have it a time where we can, really feel relaxed and worship him the more instead of working continuously. Mm-hmm. It's the love that he has for us. And the Sabbath itself, like someone like me, like next week, weekend, I'll be working. And that's doing God's work itself, looking after my patients. So my Sabbath for next week is Wednesday. Is this Wednesday coming?
Okay.
So, like Wednesday, I will feel relaxed. I will wake up late. The kids on holiday. I will wake up late. I will have more time to read my Bible and do the things I would, because on Sunday, my family will be in church while I will be working. So I will spend more time with my family on Wednesday. Prepare what I usually do, prepare a good meal for them, let them feel that I'm there. So on Saturday and Sunday, when I'm not there with them, they will still remember that I've, that is my day of a Sabbath.
Okay.
That's how I can.
So for you as a nurse, you take whatever day off that you're, but you work to make that special for you, special with you and God, in that you make extra time for God
and
in that,
family.
But special for you and family in that you've got kids, some in school, some at university, you've got a husband who's a doctor that also works all sorts of unsocial hours. So you do all you can to make it a special family day, even though it's on a Wednesday.
Yeah.
And some days they're going to be in school on that, but you've got the evening, you've got a time to make it. So you do everything you can to make that day a special day for you and special for the family.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Susan.
For me, I look at it as... for one, I look at it, God says the seventh day you must rest. So as a Christian, I think sometimes we tend to disrespect God's commands, that we don't really take it to heart. And I think we just think, oh, well, it's Sunday today, I can worship tomorrow. And I think for me, it's a breakdown in obeying God's commands that honor that day. And it's a day to be put aside, is really to worship him and focus on him and to rest your body, to gain strength, to be strong for him in the next days to come. But for me, basically, I think it's just we've just lost respect for God's commandment.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I think, okay, Joan?
I think it's rather ironic that for many of us, Sunday is one of the busiest days of the week with our church commitments and all. Today, for example, we have a morning of worship and teaching, and then we have the members' meeting. It's quite a busy day. And is that rest? And I don't know.
Not for the pastor.
Not
for anybody. No, absolutely, absolutely. I didn't mean that dismissively. It's okay. It's okay. I think there are some important principles here. I think there is this principle that for us as an individual, we must have as a part of our regular life cycle, proper rest and relaxation, a day of rest and relaxation. And for those that work in professions where, you know, nurses, doctors, and lots of other things as well, you can't control that, which day that is going to be. So that if you're in that sort of job, you also need to make that a day that is going to be a day for you and God, and a day that is going to be for you and family and relationships. Because one of these important principles here is about relationships. And we are so busy, so much time doing stuff, we don't have time for relationships. And I don't think that for many people, Sunday, for us in church here, particularly if you're involved in church leadership or in ministry, that Sunday actually is the equivalent to the Sabbath in the way that this is here at all. Because, you know, if you were here today, there were people here in this building before 8 o'clock or at 8 o'clock this morning, getting things prepared. There'll be people here probably till 4 or 5 this afternoon. I don't mean that's how long the members' meeting's going to be, but by the time we've cleared up and everything at the end of that, members' meeting's only going to be about an hour. So, you know, this is not a day of rest. Yes, it's a day for spending with God. Yes, it's a day for hearing God speak. But actually, there also needs to be time for relaxation and refreshment outside of this, in addition to this as well. And that needs to be built in. This is part of how God has made us. So we need to move on. The final verse we're going to look at today, verse 12. Already had this quoted in the meeting this morning. Honour your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Now, we need to understand that this is not addressed to children, i.e. minors. Because if it was addressed to minors, it would be talking about obeying. This is about honouring. And this really is countercultural to our culture here. In our culture, in the West here, in the UK and elsewhere, actually, it is youthfulness that is honoured, not age. And if you doubt that, let's go back to the comment we had earlier on about people worshipping their bodies. Put your hand up if you know somebody who consciously does stuff to their body to make themselves look older. Why is that? The reason is because our society is youth-focused. We might say a lot of negative things about young people and youth and this they do and that they do, but most people have got so caught up with this this lie of eternal youthfulness that people spend a fortune. I mean, don't take this personally, but people spend a fortune on treatments and lotions and potions and tablets and surgery and this, that and the other to make themselves look younger, don't they? Why is that? It's because our society values youth and no longer values age. Look at the way older people are treated so often in our society. They're not respected. They are disrespected. And in this context here, this is not about older people in general. This is about us and our parents, honouring our parents. I need to be slightly careful how I express this, but one of the things that I find very distressing in some of the time that I spend with older people, when I talk about their families, is that their children, grown-up children, do not care for them at all. Do not see them, do not visit them, are not attentive to them, do nothing towards them at all. And I see that so often. And it makes me both very sad and it also makes me very angry. And by the way, this is something that we visit on the next generation. Because that is why it says here, this is a key to social stability. Because let me tell you this, if you don't honour your parents, your kids are not going to look after you. You're going to teach them a model of life which they will follow. And our society needs to be challenged about this. In both Old and New Testaments, it's very clear that it is the experience and the life of older people that is honoured and reflected. And we need to be, as Christians, Christians often struggle with the fact they're getting older. I mean, it's going to happen to you people. You know, this time next year, you'll be a year older than you are today. I'm sorry if that comes as a shock to you. And it's not a problem. Okay, we get older, we grow older gracefully with God, allowing God to be at work in our lives and situations. And you know, people, I still find it, some Christians, it seems a big thing when they reach the big, whatever it is, 4-0 or 5-0 or whatever it is. Please, what is wrong with people? Okay, it's great to celebrate the fact you've got a bit older, but why is it an issue? Why is it an issue? It's an issue because we've taken a lie from our society about youthfulness. But we need to be honouring our parents. Let's just take a couple of minutes. A minute, 1 minute. Some ways that we can be honouring parents in our society. How should we be doing that? What does it mean? Yes.
Love your parents.
To love your parents and respect them, yeah.
You see your parents struggling in an area where you know you can help. You can help.
So there are two things about that. One, you've got to be attentive to your parents. You've got to know if they're struggling in some area. Then you've got to be willing to help them. So two very important things there. Yeah, being aware of what's going on in their lives and looking ways you can help them. Yeah, Ehi.
To be caring.
Very important there. And this is one of the keys to a stable society. And it's something that we are losing here in our culture and society. So in the last couple of minutes, let's draw these things together from this morning. What are the key things that we take away from this morning? Again, as I always say, or nearly always say, it isn't about what we learn today, it's about how we live tomorrow in the light of what we've learned today. So what do we take away from this passage that we've looked at this morning? What are the key things? Yes.
That God is supreme and he should be the center of our focus.
God is supreme and he should be the absolute center for us, our focus. Yes, what else?
We shouldn't worship any false image of God.
No worshipping of images of God, false images of God. What else?
We should love each other, have that uniformity among ourselves, love each other for good and share that Christ make us all and just show that passion for one another.
Okay, so we need to have those relationships kept.
It doesn't have to be physical, but it has to be.
Yep, relationships together. Yes, Sandra.
To honour and respect God's name.
To honour and respect God's name, yes, Trevor.
To evaluate and assess yourself daily.
Say again.
To evaluate and assess yourself daily.
To evaluate and to assess ourselves daily. Three things that seem to me the key things coming out this morning. undivided commitment to God, the importance of a day of rest, whatever that means for us in our own contexts, and honouring of parents. Let's stand together. Our time has gone. Let me pray for you as we come to an end this morning. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for the way that it speaks across the ages into our lives and situations today, as relevant today as when it was first spoken. As when you first spoke to your people, you brought these 10 words, these 10 commandments, as relevant today. Thank you that you care as much about us as you did about those people. Father, I ask that you will help us this week to live out these principles in our lives. No other gods before you, no idols, not bringing your name into disrepute, having a proper day of rest in relationship with you and with family, and honouring our parents. Father God, help us to do all of these things in our lives, that we will be, in our contexts, salt and light. Changing the context and situations that we find ourselves in. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.